So I'm not going to bore you with strategy and things, but just to give you a bit of context about me and where we are in HMRC right now. So as I said, I've worked in HMRC for some time. It really started really in about 2012 when we started working on our digital strategy, and then we started with the GDS and pan government in terms of bringing government up to a little bit more of a, shall we say, current flavour of digital services. We've got a pretty good track record with electronic business, so call it of the 1.1 billion transactions that we're responsible for in HMRC, the largest in government, about 75% of that comes from third parties and APIs, which is what I'm going to talk about quite a bit today. Strategy Online, have a look at that. It's come along for a few iterations since 2012. So I head up HMRC's software developer collaboration teams, so name I made up, because I didn't like the amount I was given a drawing to. I've been with this team probably since around May, so a few months now. Prior to that, I was working as a product owner on what's now become my personal tax account. It was one of the exemplar services that we worked with GDS and various government departments as we transformed government. It was 25 exemplar services. So this was about each government department trying to figure out a good way in which to deliver digital services. We're not unlike most other huge government departments. We were very much in a waterfall kind of trap, shall I say. And we were also working with some quite big systems and service integration. Probably lost a lot of our innovation, if I'm being perfectly honest. And our services weren't that great, even though we were big. You don't get a choice to do business with HMRC, you kind of got to do it. So we can't kind of really brag about the number of users, the number of transactions, where else are you going to go? But over the past 15 years or so, I've done a bit of history since I've joined this work, we've worked with the software industry. As I said, about 75% of everything we do now comes in from third parties. Software providers who hold that by our public APIs. This is what you see right now on grid.uk for some of our documentation. It works. That's about the best I'm going to kind of say. It's quite limited. So there's literally about 26 different services that you can integrate with, as you can see. It's not a way of searching or filling out kind of who does what. It is pretty much documentation lifted up and shoved on a website. It's all based around XML and a kind of Lightning Store kind of experience, which is a GovTalk header. Those of you kind of familiar with working with government, getting things through the different data, which is our central authentication hub. We kind of, to create these services, we work with a couple of partners. We create something called a business requirement. This is all done kind of very much kind of sequential. We turn that into our rules interface management service, which then churns out a bunch of XML schemas and schema trials with various bits and pieces. And then we just dump it onto the website, pretty much. So it kind of looks like this. So just picking a random here, page one, document after document. Guidance notes, it is literally a library online. So we've literally lifted our paper documentation from the website. It works, okay? But I think a big reason for the lack of growth in new software developers working with us is kind of this stuff. It's pretty much written where you've got to have a very good understanding of tax law and legislation. It's not very good. So I was really pleased when I was asked to help write this thing, which we did towards the back end of 2015, last year, probably coming up to its 1 year anniversary actually now, which was our new strategy for third-party software and APIs. And there's only kind of a couple of things you want to realize again, and it's all lines of you have a look. Is pretty much that. So we want to grow the market of developers and intermediaries. We want to open up HMRC. You know, we want to be very open in terms of bringing data into HMRC and taking data out of HMRC. Don't worry, everybody's taxpayer data is going to be still very secure, but we want to open up and make sure that people who want to send data into HMRC, people who want to get data out of HMRC, can do so in a secure manner. We have about 1,000 different developers nationwide who work with HMRC, some of the big guys like Iris and Sage and other accounting packages, to some more progressive, shall we say, and newer developers who are in the tax market, such as Receipt Bank, Crunch, and various people like that, Insure, OCG.TV, a fortune in advertising. So we very much want to grow the market. We want to bring more developers and more intermediaries to be able to interact with HMRC in a secure fashion. One of those initial XML APIs that I showed you, they are you to do essentially one thing, and that's send data into HMRC. So if you're a pay-as-you-earn organisation, you employ staff, you pay them pay-as-you-earn, you might pay them national insurance contributions as well, you can send that through to HMRC. But then when you make a payment as an employer, you want to check and see where your position is, there's no API that enables you to do that. It's very much a kind of one-way kind of ticket. So we want to stimulate the demand for services and open up HMRC to become more of an integrated kind of offering for software developers and their clients. So you can post data into HMRC, you can get feedback, you can manage everything through APIs. We set out to develop an API developer hub, and we wanted to move away from the documentation that I showed you earlier. I'll just give you a bit of background, I guess, really, in terms of how we sort of set ourselves up to do that. So at this point, towards, I guess, December 15, we've been building digital services, but these are internal applications within HMRC. We've done some really good things. I think we built our tax platform, which was a cloud-based active-active platform with two different providers. We've broken away from our service and systems integration contracts, which was and we started to build digital centres across HMRC because we're quite a big organisation. Pretty much everyone in the UK kind of touches with HMRC, whether you're an individual paying income tax or a business paying corporation tax, an agent or an intermediary, you pretty much will have some form of contact with HMRC. So we started to set up a distributed network of digital centres. There's one here in London, in South Bank, Dorset House, some of you might have been there, and we've got a big centre in Newcastle now, and we've got one in Telford, Worthing, where I'm from in Leeds, building the Northern Powerhouse in Leeds, so we've got one as well, which is great. And we've pretty much sort of adopted, I wouldn't say we're the most mature organisation in the world, but we've pretty much adopted Scrum, and we, in terms of building our APIs and building our services, we generally have now kind of 8 to 10 people in each Scrum team. In terms of content, we generally have a content designer. For APIs, that content designer works very closely with the technical architects and developers, and multidisciplinary teams. And we've started to move into that way of operating. So not only do we build our internal applications that we offer up, so personal tax account, for instance, is a HMRC application you guys can use. Our APIs will also be same methodology. One thing within the strategy that we wanted to drive home was that we want to become an API-first organisation. So what that means is we build the API, we then decide where we actually expose it. So do we actually expose that through a HMRC application? It might be there's no market for it in third-party software market, there's no need there for it. We might expose it as well. So some of those early services, we build services, the industry builds services as well. But with the strategy, it's all about making sure that we actually build the service via an API, and it's the API that then goes out or not, not some kind of customized or more specialized thing. So, so that's a bit about background. We use this thing, Heroku. You guys use this, but it's a good thing for us to use to do the quick prototyping. You can pretty much see a history of everything we've ever done on the development, which is great to kind of, as a retrospective, kind of look back and see how we've changed, you know, how the UX has changed, how the documentation has changed. So we pretty much from July started to iterate our developer hub and the way in which we create API documentation. It's gone through about 3 dozen, maybe even more, different iterations in a short space of time. We started with developer with beta and getting to the developer. I'm really sure about the other kind of thing. So every week we essentially in the lab, whether that's kind of virtual or whether that's kind of through a hangout or what have you, testing where we are with our developer content design. But there's some key features in terms of what developers need on the developer. There's registrations, tutorials. We're using a standard way of building RESTful JSON-based APIs. We've got to know off two for our security integration. And very recently looking towards around the top, I'll come to it as well. But practically every sprint, a couple of weeks, we're looking at 2 sprints. We're checking in with our users, we're looking at how things are working for them. We'll do very quick prototypes in Heroku. Our content designer with our UX design developers work very closely on doing that. We'll do some testing with that and we'll try and flow that back into our development side as well. So we've got a bit of a cadence in terms of how we're doing that now as well. That's working pretty good. So we started with really basic kind of very first UX design of our developer. Just kind of starting to figure out where the user journey is really. Let's kind of fast forward in terms of so here's our publicly available developer that we are top spinning out with people interested. But this is where we are now. This is our developer still in beta. You'll know if I kind of flip back to here, so this is the demonstration. You can kind of see where we started in the top left hand corner there to kind of where we are now in terms of the iterations of the UX and kind of how that's changed. It's very much kind of built, so this is how you see. Built around the kind of user journey that the software developer having to work with the patient. The ability to get started using the developer, how you will then register and set yourself up as authorization, which works really well because from an off-time perspective, there's a kind of a handoff between the client and the user of the software to make sure that you are using the software that you're intending to use and that the credential and matches within HMRC. The documentation itself in terms of the APIs, I'll show you a little bit. Some reference guidance and then some integration with our sandbox environment as well. The API normally has a documentation but a sandbox implementation as well for you to a production state. So just to give you a bit of a context, so this is our QA environment. A bunch of APIs. We're still pretty mature with this, if I'm being honest. It's just a list for me to do. We're looking at how better to include kind of searching and looking at context around this and helping to find the APIs that we're looking for. But this was kind of a previous implementation of our documentation. Using Nothing, this was pretty much kind of built from scratch by developers. Pretty much a series of RESTful API endpoints. Big part of the strategy is trying to build kind of more sort of granular based APIs or endpoints, should I say. So that moving away from our history, rather than just kind of looking at form and trying to map that form to an API and making sure that all the box fields and what kind of stuff kind of set. What we really want to do is just expose our data out in the best possible way. And that means the most friendly way because software developers want to build applications here that are not constrained or bound by any sort of constraints. You know, if they build an SA100 form, everyone knows it. Unfortunately, I'm starting to know what this is. You can build applications which maybe bring different points together. So a good example of that maybe is here. So we've some ability to bring back some individual details. We're very keen to make sure that we try and describe the API so that we are self-describing. So you'll notice kind of reference to tax regimes. There's a self-assessment over here with corporation tax over here, trying to move away from all that. And we're also trying to make them, as I said, self-describing so that developers understand them. Very keen to get the UX right from the developer's perspective so that developers can hopefully then get it right from a client perspective as well. Remove any constraints that may well be while previously. So you may have noticed that every single API has some sort of tax regime kind of nomenclature to it, which we've got to move away from. So for instance, you might have crashing an application which brings back somebody's individual income, and then employment history perhaps, and then tax, and if they have benefits with their employment, for benefits, etc., you can bring that back too. But if you have an application which doesn't deal with that, doesn't deal with employee benefits, because you know, your particular application you don't need to include that, then you don't need to include that API. I think historically, HMRC would build like a huge kind of monolithic endpoint with loads of detail that probably wasn't needed for everybody. So trying to be a lot more granular in terms of how we actually design our APIs. That was relatively recently in terms of documentation and moving to here. This is just one endpoint. So we then have the source and localization. We give a view on what a successful response looks like. Error scenarios, sandbox details, sandbox data. And the more work we've done with developers, this becomes important. They're able to see. So the 200 is fine, but give me all the error scenarios as well. Let me test my product so that I can understand every single response that I can get back from HMRC. I think we need to do a little bit more here in terms of the definition. For instance, so 401, you currently say it's invalid credentials. So that could be that the bearer token that the software product is used to contact HMRC is invalid. Could be end user credential, so you're given a data user ID, invalid, or if you're an agent or an intermediary acting on someone's behalf, it could be that that's invalid as well. You need to be a little more specific in terms of exactly why the credential is invalid. So when you are, and this is pretty much the last kind of few weeks, really, so bringing that together when you are. Okay, same, this is our sort of first step into RAML. I don't know if anybody uses RAML. We sort of had a bit of a technical kind of face off between Swagger and RAML. There wasn't a great deal in being perfect friends. But this is our sort of first foray into using something such as RAML, trying to kind of better describe a better articulate the problem today. So you'll notice immediately the lesson version comes up there. We spread that right up front. And developers are having to kind of click through the API to try and find out which version it is. You've not heard of version control yet, by the way, as well. That's the first thing you notice. Then we're going to the document itself. Got a warning up front here regarding breaking changes. This is as much HMRC moving away and kind of helping and supporting the industry. Because historically, we've pretty much published an API document in October, ready for the new tax year starting in April, and allowing developers 6 months to essentially test and market their product. We're moving in more of an agile fashion now, but we can't expect a lot of developers to be exactly the same. It's very much used to work in that same way. And it's kind of a mixed kind of reception right now with, I guess, some of the smaller developers wanting to work this in that fashion, wanting to kind of accept the changes and we can deploy pretty much every day. Things, but we've got to respect that we're not just building our own products, we're not in complete control of this, we're developing an API which is being consumed by third-party software. We're only run Braze, Sage's accounting software, for instance, or Intuit's accounting software. So we've got to measure and sort of manage the version control quite carefully. So this is just the beta currently. But as you see, the sort of run-wide view of the documentation, really more kind of around description, version errors, layouts a little better, I think. Feedback's been quite good around this. I think I'm getting to the resources and the endpoints. Gives me the same sort of information, but I think the organization. friendly. I said the initial kind of usage of this has been quite universally positive, I guess, really. So I think this is a good thing to do. Whether we kind of continue on the wrong path or whether we look at other things such as Swagger as well, who knows, whether we're going to be a expert and whether we're going to as we're in our pizza section. Solutions, so that's some good reason for us in HMRC to have a look at. But actually, mentioned in the sort of the popular ones in terms of the optimized specification of RAML. We've been, somebody mentioned that earlier. So we've done a lot of testing with RAML now users internally as well in terms of where we're at sort of technically. It seems to be the best fit for us right now, but you know, for an agile operation, so we can change. So I think I'm great set pen of idea. I'm going to sort out a few people that are still around, so Ben and Chris who's come from, and some very interesting stuff that you guys do. And so we're quite sort of, I think, an immature organization right now in terms of our APIs. Huge transactions, but that's because no one else can go anywhere else to play that tap, of course. Thank you for listening to me. Got time for any questions now? More than happy to take them or see you in the pub.
A minute.
Okay.
One question.
You mentioned you're moving away from specific tax, like self-assessment, to more generic terms. I was just wondering if there was any discussions or plans to create a scheme or standards across different countries, different tax regimes, so that there could be like a consistent way of how tax is described around the world, so that software developers could easily modify their application from one country to the next, so then each country is doing its own thing.
It's a great question. I think the first challenge for us is to get UK government jobs. We didn't get any last year. Because those first 26 APIs that I showed you practically have been dead silent. So if you look at even kind of getting something as simple as a consistent kind of data structure of a data or a national insurance form or unique taxpayer records. There is inconsistencies with our data model. And one of that is more about legacy back-end integration, because the system is just kind of old and inconsistent. So I think there's a lot for us to do in terms of customer going to HMRC, well, I'm using that word, but doing HMRC. I'm doing my business, I want to pay my GST, I want to pay my corporation tax, some people, so I've got to pay them pay as well in national insurance. I can use your services, and it's a very consistent and joined up model. So you know the great things about making tax digital, which is our kind of big program to try and kind of remove those silos and deal with people as kind of as taxpayers. They're having VAT look over here, when you can do your pay as your own bit over here, it's very different. But we do have an international stakeholder group, if you like, with a lot of our European partners, and we also work with the US as well with the IRS. So who knows, we may get to a point where that simply will be some way to sort of get a worldwide standardization, but wouldn't it be great? Thank you very much.